I'm Jerry Kraut. This is my dad, Charles Kraut. He's Grandpa Charles. He's Daddy Charles. He's Uncle Charles. He's just plain Charles to his mother, to his wife, I mean. He was Charlesy as a child to his stepmom. So, met multiple names, but the same old guy. Anyway, what we'd like to do today is to go over interesting aspects of my dad's life. So before we do that, though, Dad.
Yes?
I want you to tell me a little bit about your dad's name is Joseph, right?
You and
your mom was Reva.
Yes.
Okay. So I just want the names of all of Joseph's siblings. That's all I need. Joseph's siblings. Do you remember that?
Yeah. Rose, Oscar, Harry, Yetta.
Yeah. One, two, three, four.
So Oscar and Harry were Krauts.
Yes.
Rose Messi?
No.
Nehemia.
Rose Nehemia.
Uh-huh.
And Oscar Kraut, I said that. And he had one brother, Isidore, who died when I was very, very young.
Joseph had a brother named Isidore?
Yes.
Okay, anybody else? That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 kids total.
I think that's right.
Okay, and how about for Reva?
Just a moment.
Oh, yes?
He had a brother by the name of Sam, who lived in New York.
Wow. And how about Reva?
Reva.
Her brothers and sisters were?
Rose.
Another Rose.
Celia, Ida, Herman, I think that was all.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Your mother, Charles.
5.
Yeah.
Okay, so now as you can see, there's nothing wrong with his memory, better than mine, that's for sure. And the reason I wanted to do this is as a frame of reference when we start talking about different relatives during some of the discussion. All right, Dad. So,
yeah.
do you know where your first apartment was that you lived in?
Yes.
What was your first apartment that you lived in?
900 East 62nd Street.
And when was that about?
I think shortly after I was born, when I was a...
Oh, that was your first apartment?
Yeah.
And how
well, the first apartment, I was an infant, we lived on the near north side. But I forgot where it was. I didn't know where it was.
Okay, so you had one on the north side and then one on 62nd Street?
Yes.
Did you ever have to live behind a store?
No,
you never had to live behind a store.
No.
Okay. And for how many years did you live in an apartment on 62nd Street? Would you say?
About 3 or 4.
3 or 4, and then where?
Then we moved to 6120 South Greenwood.
61st and Greenwood?
Yes.
How long did you stay there? That was a nice apartment?
That was a better apartment. Very nice. When I was... until my mother got sick.
Okay. So that's where you lived until you were, what, about 10 or 11 or something?
No, until I was about 8.
Until you were about 8.
Yeah.
All right. And so you went to the Chicago Public Schools there?
Yes, I went to the John Fisk, F-I-S-K-E, Grammar School.
Remember any teachers' names by any chance?
I remember my kindergarten teacher's name.
Really?
Her name was Mrs. Guest.
How do you spell that?
G-U-E-S-T. guest.
She must have been very nice if you remember her all those years.
I remember her because she used to always comment that I had a deep voice. I don't know if I still have it or not, but she had a name for me, but I can't remember what it was.
That was a kindergarten teacher.
Yeah. Well,
can you remember any interesting or special events or occasions that happened during those years, during those 8 years at the fifth school?
Well,
before high school.
Yeah. We lived with my maternal grandmother, Sarah Shover. And Sarah used to call me Chelsea. And they told me that when I was an infant, I was pretty bright, because
you were a bright infant.
Yeah, because I used to crawl around, and anytime I saw him, I would pull myself up. And when I saw it wasn't my mother, I would drop down. The only one I wouldn't go to was my mother.
Well, you seem to be very smart, I guess.
That's about all that I remember. Oh, I do remember that my mother, as I got a little older, used to take me on the elevated railroad train and downtown to the department stores, and I loved it, sitting in the train and riding up high above everything and imagining all kinds of things. And she would take me down, buy me toys and things like that.
Was your family fairly well off? These were in the 20s, right?
Yes, I thought we were, because my father had a store, and he bought a 1927 7-passenger Nash touring car, which was sort of a luxury in those years. And I thought we were well off.
Yeah. So for those first 8 years, you lived mostly in the apartment in Greenwood, and your dad was running his tailor business.
Yeah, that was at 942 East 63rd Street.
Well, that was before the one at 1135.
Yes.
Okay. And tell me about your sisters during those years.
My sisters.
Did you have much to do with them?
Yeah, we were like a family. We used to play together.
Were you a difficult big brother?
No.
You were nice to them?
No.
You were the oldest, or Harriet?
She was he was the middle.
Harriet was the oldest. She was 15 months older than me.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And did you go to Hebrew school during those years?
Yes, I went to Hebrew school.
Do you remember the temple?
It's a temple, B'nai B'tzalel.
B'Tzalel.
Yeah, B'Tzalel.
Well, that's interesting, because that's your name, B'Tzalel.
B'Tzalel is my Hebrew name.
Okay. All right, so now we're going to switch from the grammar school days and go to the high school days.
Yes.
Or until, you know, let's talk about after 8 years old, from 8 to 15.
Yeah.
Tell us, is that when you went to the orphanage?
Yes.
And your mom died, and your dad decided that the best thing to do, number one, is to let some of the relatives take some of the responsibility, since there was nobody at home in his house to take care of you because he had to work. Is that correct?
Yes. I always think that was the wrong decision, because he could have hired a housekeeper, I think, and kept us in an apartment. But anyhow, he had a brother in New York by the name of Sam. Sam had some relative who was involved with the orphan home, which was a charity thing, and and they told my dad that he'd be better off to put the three children in the orphan home because we'd all be together.
Was that before or after you went to the relatives?
Before. After. First, they parceled us out, one child to each relative.
Okay, so who did, so?
I went to Aunt Rose Nehemia.
Aunt Rose Nehemia, that was your dad's sister?
Knox's mother.
That was your father's sister?
Yeah.
Okay, and where did Harriet go?
Harriet went to Aunt Florence. That was Harry Kraut's wife.
Okay, Harry Kraut. So it's also your father's.
My father's family.
Brother, yes.
And Natalie went to Aunt Hannah. That was my mother's family.
That was Uncle Herman's wife.
Herman Schober's wife, yeah.
Okay.
You and Lou Knox were first cousins.
Yes.
Yeah, he and his siblings were staying with his first cousins.
Mm-hmm.
One on his mom's side and two on his father's side. Okay, how long did that last, Dad?
I have no idea, but I don't think it was too long. Yeah.
And that was when the idea came from Uncle Sam from New York, and he suggested that Joseph should stop sending you kids to relatives.
Yeah.
That instead he thinks, since he had a connection with the Jewish orphanage, he suggested to Joseph that that's where you should go.
Yeah.
And then, so that's when you went after maybe a year or two or three.
You know, a couple of years or a year or two, I remember I went to grammar school on the west side for that short time.
Which short time that you were with Knox?
When I was with Aunt Rose, yeah.
When you were staying with your relatives and Natalie and Harriet were staying with their relatives, did you have regular get-togethers?
Well, on Sundays, my father would go to one aunt or the other, and we would see them then.
Okay. Do you remember that time that you were with your relatives as pleasant? Do you remember it fondly? Were you just very upset because of the loss of your mother at that time? How would you describe that time for you?
Well,
with the relatives, those few years.
I was not a good kid.
Really?
No. Aunt Rose used to complain a lot about me. I was stubborn.
Did you do bad things, or you just didn't mind what she said?
Well, I would. I remember one incident. She lived on Holman Street near Jackson Boulevard. She used to tell this about me, really. And that's a very busy street, and she wanted me to carry a package across the street. I didn't want to do it, so she says, I stood there and I said, okay, I'll stand here and get hit by a car.
So that's where you got your stubborn streak?
I don't know, but I don't
showed
remember.
Your stubborn streak?
She used to tell that about me. I don't remember it all that well. But she was very loving and very nice. I had no problem. Her husband Max was very nice. They were near the Sears Roebuck store on the west side on Arthington Street, and Uncle Max used to take Knox and me to the baseball games every weekend.
Which baseball games?
They used to have a game in the parking lot of Sears.
Softball game, you mean, huh?
I don't remember.
Oh, okay. All right, so your father then met Effie.
He met Effie after we were in the orphan home.
Right. You were in the orphan home for how long?
I think it was about 2 years or 3 years.
Yeah. Well, before we leave the orphan home, why don't you tell us some stories about the orphan home?
Did
you love it or did you hate it there?
It was at 62nd and Drexel, a few blocks from my father's store. And it was really a charity place, basically. It was with the United Jewish Charities, I think. And I did not like it there. They said that the three kids would be together, but we really were not.
You didn't see each other very much?
No, because they were in the girls' section, and I was in the boys' section. And the big accent was with physical activities like baseball and football, and I was very, very bad player.
Oh, you weren't very athletic, and they did a lot of athletics there.
Very uncoordinated. And they used to pick sides for ball games, and I was always the last one picked. Nobody wanted me.
Some things never change.
I have that too.
And then they used to put me in right field, which is where
nobody hit the ball, huh?
Where nobody hit the ball, and I
you wouldn't make an error out there.
Well, I could make an error. I used to not catch the ball. and then I also, even at that age, I thought my father really didn't have to do this, put us here, because he was in a position to and could have hired a housekeeper and kept the family together.
So from the time that that Riva got sick, it was a couple of years before she passed away? She was hospitalized?
I think it was about two or three.
So there's all that time, and then while you were in the home, she passed away?
Yeah.
And then it was another period of time?
Yeah. And I must have been about 10 and a half or so when she passed away, because that's an incident that I always thought they shouldn't have taken a 10-year-old kid to. It was very traumatic for me.
You went to the funeral?
Yeah, they took me to the funeral.
That's what you're referring to as a traumatic event?
Yeah.
What about the shoes, Gerald?
I saw all my aunts and all my relatives were crying, and made a deep impression in my mind. One time, I needed a pair of shoes, and they gave me a pair of shoes, but they were used shoes. They were some charity shoes.
Who gave you the shoes?
At the orphan home. I didn't like them at all, and I didn't want to wear them. They said, "You got to wear them. That's yours. You were not supposed to leave the orphan home without permission." But I got mad and I left.
You ran away?
I went to my father's store, which was about two blocks away. And I was crying, and I went in there, and my father was not in the store. Uncle Harry was there. He was working with my father at that time. And I came in crying and upset, and he said, "What's the matter?" I said, "Look at these terrible shoes they gave me." So he says, "Come on." He took me next door. It was a shoe store. And he bought me a pair of shoes. And then I was happy and I went back.
Well, that was a very kind thing to do, huh?
They told him it was the wrong thing to do.
Oh, the orphanage did.
Yeah, that was the wrong way to train kids.
Yeah.
And, but I was more pleased with my new shoes, and I got over it. And then in the summertime, every year in August, the Jewish Charities would have a big picnic for the orphan kids from all the orphanages in Chicago, and for the old people, and it was in Lincoln Park. My father used to drive us, to take a load of kids and drive us to the picnic. And
yep,
I used to like those.
Yeah.
I used to like those very much. They would give us toys and games and hot dogs and all that.
Tonight,
I used to like those outings. Other than that, I really don't remember much else. In later years, I thought that it was a Jewish orphanage, but they gave the kids no Jewish education.
So it was Jewish in name only, but not religious.
Very, very super reform. They used to have they had a big chapel there. I remember that. And they used to go there about once a week, and that's about it.
Were you able to go to Hebrew school someplace else from the orphanage?
No.
No, that was later.
That was after I went to the synagogue, Hebrew school. And when I lived on 61st and Greenwood, Lewis Knox was taking violin lessons. He lived on the west side, on Roosevelt and Kedzie. And they decided I should have violin lessons. So I used to go every Saturday morning on the streetcar.
From home?
From 61st and Greenwood.
How old were you?
I was about maybe 8 or 9. I used to go by myself on the streetcar.
That was before you were living in the orphanage.
Yeah, while I still lived on Greenwood. And I used to go on the streetcar, and I used to go every Saturday at the same time with my violin case. And the motorman got to know me. And he used to let me stand up in the front where the motormen were and open the door, pull the lever to open the door. So I got to be friends with the motorman, and I used to like that.
Were you bar mitzvahed?
Later on, after I got to the orphan home.
When you were how old?
13.
At 13, okay.
So you left the orphan home finally when your dad got remarried?
Yes.
And he married?
He married a nice lady by the name of Effie Seckbach, S-E-C-K-B-A-C-H.
Did she have a Yiddish accent or American?
No, she was born in, she had a very, very strong Southern accent. And she was born in New Orleans. Hmm. She was 39 years old, never married.
How did they meet, you know?
I think Uncle Harry's wife might have known her, but I'm really not sure how they met. And then he used to come with her on Sundays to the orphan home to pick us up. They used to go to one of the aunts or uncles or take us someplace.
This was after he married her?
What?
Those trips that he took with her?
Yeah.
And you and the kids?
Yeah.
Was that after he married her?
No. Before. That's how I got to know her. I remember he used to stop at a certain bagel
place.
That's
when he was dating her.
Yes.
All right, and then when he married her, then you got a free pass out of that orphanage, huh?
He married her on December 29th. And she decided that the kids want to go away from the home so much, we're not going to have a honeymoon. And she rented an apartment at 6044 Ingleside, not far from the other apartment. It was a two-bedroom apartment. They had a bedroom, my sisters had a bedroom, and I slept on a cot in the dining room. I thought it was great.
compared to that to that orphanage, I'm sure it was.
Well, we had 30 kids in a dormitory.
And now you were still in grade school, or had gone to high started high school?
I was in grade school. I think I was about the seventh grade or something like that. And they married on the 29th of December. We moved into the apartment on the 30th of December. And where do you think I went on the 31st of December? I went back to the orphan home. And I told my friends, I want you to come over and see this great apartment that we live in. So I brought about five of them over to the apartment. Now, Effie was a wonderful, wonderful cook. She had planned a New Year's Eve party to celebrate her marriage. And she had spent a couple of days preparing things at the for the big party. And so I'm being a good host, I said, "You guys want something to eat?" And I opened the refrigerator door, and I said, "Here." I gave them all the food she prepared. And she came back. The house was all messed up, and no more food. And I remember what she said.
What did she say?
She said, "Charles, I'm going to tell your father on you." And with that, she got busy in the afternoon, and she prepared a whole new bunch of food, and she went ahead with her party. And she used to like to tell that story of how she got acquainted with her new son.
Oh, that was pretty soon after you moved back.
The day after.
Oh, the day after, yeah, 31st.
And how, were you punished?
No. They realized that we were so happy to be in the apartment that I think they excused me for doing that.
That was his friends from the orphanage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this was, I'm sorry, I'm just trying to get the time. What year did they get married?
1929.
So they got married months after the Depression started.
Well, the Depression was already in effect.
Yeah.
And
you're talking about the crash.
Yeah, the stock market crash was in October of 29, right?
In October, yeah.
And so that must have had a big impact on on their...
business got bad because people didn't buy custom-made suits. And my dad felt it very much. He had made some investments in real estate, but they went sour, and he lost all that money.
Maybe you were too young to remember, but was it like October 29th, and then immediately everybody knew things were really bad, or did it take a while for bad things were to be recognized?
It took a couple of months. Things really got bad in 1930, 31.
Right, so in terms of your schooling, now you're starting to get older. You said you had a bar mitzvah.
Yes, when my father took me out of the orphan home, I was 12 years old and didn't have any Hebrew education to speak of. So he decided he wanted me to be bar mitzvah. And he sent me to a shamus. The synagogue, I didn't go to Hebrew school anymore. He sent me to a shamus to teach me my portion in the Torah, and I used to go there after school every day, and he would work with me, and I finally learned whatever I had learned. But I did it, and Effie made a big party for me at home. She cooked and baked and did everything. I had a bar mitzvah at our apartment on the Ingleside.
That's a nice memory, huh?
Yeah. All my aunts and uncles came. They all brought me presents.
Your aunts and uncles, as I'm counting them, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, about 11.
Yeah, they brought, well,
they all came over.
They brought all
with
their
with their kids?
With their kids.
And all your cousins?
My cousins all came. It was a festive Shabbat.
Well, I'll bet. So shortly after that is when you went to high school.
Then I went to high school. I went to Hyde Park High School.
Were you there for the whole 4 years at Hyde Park?
Yes.
And do you remember any interesting stories from that time? High school stories for us?
Well, I was not a very good student. Because I did not have any social life, because my father, I used to like to give a little money for candy and stuff, and he said, "You want money? Work." So I didn't have any money, so I went and I got a job in a grocery store when I was 13 or 12. I was getting $3 a week plus tips. And I had to give the $3 a week home, and I could keep the tips. And the average tip was 10 cents. I had to pay for school supplies and candy and stuff from the tips.
That was right during the big part of the Depression.
That was during the Depression, yeah. I remember one time when I first started working, I worked for a Greek grocery man by the name of George. And he had a produce and grocery store on 63rd and Ingleside. And I used to deliver the things in a coaster wagon, a kid's coaster wagon. Christmas time, that must have been 1930, the next year, some nuns came in and bought a Christmas tree. So, and the nuns were from a convent on 48th or 49th in Cottage Grove. So he said, "Here, Sally, streetcar fare was 3 cents for kids. Here's 6 cents. Go deliver the Christmas tree on the streetcar." So I got on the streetcar, and they wouldn't let me on because the tree was too long, too big. It was a very, very bitter cold day. I took the tree back to him. I said, "George, they won't let me on the streetcar." And he said, "That's okay, Sally." He says, "Go with the wagon." So I walked with the wagon from 63rd and Ingleside to 49th and Drexel. And it was bitter cold. And I came in, the nuns saw this bundled up kid come in. They said they wouldn't let me go out. They said, "It's too cold. We gotta have some hot chocolate and cookies first." So they kept me there till I warmed up, and they gave me hot chocolate and cookies. And that's an act of kindness I'll never forget.
It is. Take a glass of water, Dad.
Huh?
Just take a drink of water for your throat. That is a nice act of kindness, no question about it.
And when they felt I was sufficiently warm, they
let you go.
They let me go back, and I walked back. By the time I got back, I was pretty cold.
Wow.
Tell them about the peaches.
Pearl. Don't have to remind me. I'm not senile yet.
What about the peaches? We might as well hear about the peaches since we already heard that.
That's another grocery store when I was in high school.
Okay. I'm game.
Well, after I got out of grammar school, is there some Kleenex over there?
Yeah. I'm going to stop this for a second. And, so you can tell us about the peaches.
Because your lovely wife says you got to tell us about the peaches.
Well, when I got out of grammar school and went to high school, I got another job at across the street at another grocery store. And the same kind, a Greek grocery store. I think I was getting $5 a week there, plus tips. And they were known for their produce. All the women used to come there to get produce because Jim, the owner, used to go to the market at 4 o'clock in the morning and buy the best produce and then have it back to the store by 8:30, and they'd always have good fresh produce. They didn't like it if a woman shopped at the A&P grocery or the chain grocery and then came into them and only bought fruit. They liked it if they bought canned goods from them too. So they had a system where they had a display of canned goods by the cash register. And they used to sell, in those days, they used to sell peaches in baskets. Each basket had two peaches on the bottom and six peaches on top. And they would display the baskets in the window. So Nick was one of the people who worked there, and they used to put a basket of old crummy peaches behind the display of canned goods. And if a woman bought a basket of peaches, they would say, "Lady, should I put them in a bag? It's easier to carry." And she'd say yes, and on the way back, they had a bunch of baskets of crummy peaches, moldy ones, by the cash register. They would drop the good ones and put the crummy ones in a bag and give it to her. I was about 16 years old at that time. And so this woman came in, she said, "I want that basket of peaches." And Nick had to go with a reacher. That's a long pole that can reach things. And "You want this one? No. You want this one? No. You want this one? No." Finally, he got to the one she liked. And he said, "Yeah, I want that one." And he said, "Should I put it in a basket, in a bag, lady? It's easier to carry." And she says, "Yes." So on the way back to the cash register, he dumped the good ones and give her a bag of moldy ones.
What did you think about that?
I thought it was terrible.
But you didn't tell him.
Well, I was a kid. I didn't know anything. And so this woman went next door to the theater to watch a movie. And in the middle of the movie, she decided to eat a peach. She put her hand in, they were all mush. So she came back to the grocery store after the movie, and she said, "Look at here, I know I picked out, at least I saw the six good ones on top. These are terrible." And Nick said, "Lady, that's what you picked out, and that's what you got, and I'm not going to change them." And he refused to change them for a good basket. That's all she wanted. And so they start arguing. So he said, "Lady," he said, "go F yourself." And she walked out. As I was going home that evening, about 5:30 or 6 o'clock, here she comes back with a guy about 6 feet tall. And so he says, "Is this the guy?" And she says, "Yes." He says, "Come here, I want to talk to you." And he took him in the back, and I followed them. And he said, I understand you insulted my wife this afternoon. And he said, I want you to go on your hands and knees and apologize to her. And so Nick got down on his hands and knees a little bit, and he says, no, that won't do good. That wasn't enough. He said, I want you to go on your hands and knees. And I'd never seen a man so humiliated in my life. He got on his hands and knees, and he said, I'm sorry, lady. And the man said, okay. And he got up and they went out. It's something that impressed me.
I would think so.
It's a bad way. I thought it was a terrible way to do business.
I'm surprised that didn't happen more often.
Huh?
I'm surprised that didn't happen more often with the lousy peaches.
Well, that's the only occasion I remember. A lot of people got screwed, though.
Let me change taste.
They got wrong peaches and wrong pears. That's the
go again.
Right, we're going to resume our conversation with my dad. We're up to high school days. So, you were working in the various grocery stores.
Yeah, two grocery stores, George and Nick.
Right. And then was that for the entire 4 years of high school?
Yes, I worked for George while I was in grammar school. And for Jim and Nick and Gus while I was in high school.
Do you have any other good stories about working in the grocery store during high school that you might remember?
No, the one about the peaches was in high school.
Oh, that wasn't peaches. Okay, that was in high school.
A little bit older, I could understand. I thought it was a terrible way to do business.
Yeah. So, now, this is your high school years. Now, during high school, actually, in high school,
yeah.
In terms of your relationship with teachers and your ability to do good academic work and that kind of stuff,
yeah.
What do you have to say about that?
I don't think I was too good at doing academic work. I resented all the time that I couldn't join in much of a social life. Because I had to go to work every afternoon after school for the whole 4 years. And I worked all day Saturday.
So you didn't have time to do a lot of socializing in high school?
No,
dances and
the kids went
fun
to dances.
Things like that?
They had functions, some clubs and different things. I didn't join into very much of it, a little bit, but not much. And when everybody else was all through at school and going out playing ball and doing whatever they're going to do, I had to go to work.
Well, so tell us about your graduation. Do you remember it?
I remember one incident in high school. I was kind of a mischievous student. And I had a division teacher, Mrs. Kelly. High school was across the street from Jackson Park. It was on the west side of the street. I did something wrong. I don't know what I did. So Mrs. Kelly said, okay, you're going to stay after school today. You're going to stay in the division room for 3 hours. So I didn't like that because I was going to lose my job. So I was moaning around there. And she said, okay, you want to go? I'll tell you what. You see my car across the street? That was on the east side of Stony Island by the park. And we were on the west side. She says, go wash the car and I'll let you go. So I went across the street with a bucket of water. And I washed just the west side of the car.
The side that she could see from the school.
The side that she could see from school. And the car was very, very dirty. And so she looked out the window, and she says, that's very nice, Charles, you can leave.
But you didn't wash the other side?
No. So the next day, we came back, she says, you think you're smart, don't you? She really gave me a good talking to, not to be such a smarty. And I thought, Boy, I was sharp to that.
Do you have many friends in high school?
No.
Any good friends?
No. I had one fellow by the name of Sheldon Oppenheim. And he and I were a little bit friendly. But other than that, I had no special friends.
You think that's because you were working all the time and didn't have an opportunity?
I didn't have a chance to socialize. And, you know, after school, I used to go here and go there, be together in groups. Mm-hmm. I was a lone ranger.
Hmm. All right, you were going to tell us about your graduation.
I don't remember a thing about it.
Okay.
I graduated.
And you went, just continued to work. You didn't go to college at that time.
No.
What did you do after graduation?
Graduation?
Stay with the same job in the grocery store?
I went to work for... We had a friend. Her name was Ann Wall. And her father had a grocery store on 71st and Bennett on the corner. And so I went to work for him. Full time, I think it was $8 a week.